Okay, let's do the FizzBuzz in Haskell. First, I have FizzBuzz in Python. FizzBuzz, it's this exercise where you print numbers from one to whatever, and let's say 20 in my case. And if it's divisible by 3, you print Fizz. If it's divisible by 5, you print Buzz. If it's divisible by both 3 and 5, you print FizzBuzz. So it's going 1, 2, Fizz, 4, 5, Buzz. And then the first multiple of 3 and 5 is 15 FizzBuzz here. Well, that's 4i. This is definite iteration. I is going to take all the values between 1 and actually 19 here, because ranges in Python do not include the upper bound. I first test for divisibility for both with modulo, you know, the remainder is equal to 0, because if I test for that, it's going to print fizz, but like not go into that branch. Then the 3, then the 5, else I print the number itself. Let's run this between 1 and 20. We're happy about that, or I need 1 and 19. Just to make it a bit m more ostensibly procedural, I'm going to do def fizz underscore buzz, because I want to style it like pep8. N, and I'm going to go to n, or indeed n plus 1, right? Because if I want up to 20, my range needs to go up to 19, indent all of that so it's nice. And then in my main, get some white space at the bottom, white space. I'm going to call fizzbuzz, I can't have a fizzbuzz of 20. And I need a colon in here to control enter to run it, or apple enter in my case. And that's because I misspelled it. Yes, okay. That's FizzBuzz, right? That's FizzBuzz, which has all the sort of really this procedural. The procedural paradigm is very, very illustrated because this is a procedure because no return value, but side effect. Side effect is printed to the screen, right? We're changing the type of the machine. This is iteration, definite. FO, and we get selection. And implicitly, we have sequence because we are print doing one thing after the other at each iteration of the loop. Remember, like iteration needs to be built up on sequence. So if you don't have sequence, you don't have iteration. This could be interesting to do that in Haskell because Haskell doesn't have some of those what we consider to be basic programming things, but there are other ways to program. Okay, I've like 2 minutes and a half. That's good. Now we're going to take quite a lot longer to do it in Haskell. So, a couple of things to know. How do I do divisibility? I can do it like that. Even x equal. Now I can do selection in Haskell, but I'm not selecting between branches of code because I don't really have sequences of instruction. But I can select between different values to return. Now, those values can themselves be functions. So, de facto, you can effectively switch between tracks and branches of the code. So, even x equals if x is divisible by 0. Now, that's remember, we're in prefix notation. So, the modulo operator is not the percent character, it's mod. And we are in prefix notation, which means to do mod. So, that's mod x to let's put some brackets. Okay. If bracket mod x2, that means x modulo 2 is equal to 0, then I'm going to return 1, right? Else, I'm going to return 0. Now you need an else because this is an expression. It needs to unambiguously evaluate to something of the same type as well, right? You can't mix and match Haskell strictly type with type inference. So that's my even. If I say even 1. Is 0, obviously, because 1 is even 2 is 1 and 3, right? That's both the basic if and the modular arithmetic. This can be a bit confusing because it's like, well, is it x modulo 2 or 2 modulo x? So I'll show you how to write it in infix notation. So let's do a function divisible x is equal to. Now, if x, if actually mod x 5. Equal to 0. Now I need to test both, right? Like you want to test both 3 and 5 in the first one, because that's the because if you just test 3 it will be true, if you just test 5 it will be true. You want 15 to go fizz buzz, not fizz just fizz or buzz. So an end in Haskell is not end. Like this will be purple because it is a Haskell keyword, but the like Boolean end that you want is ampersand. End bracket mod x 3 close bracket is equal to 0. That's my condition. That's my condition. Then, I'm just going to indent just to show the nesting of the thing. Then, we are printing, which one is it? It's Fizzbuzz, right? Because it's 5 and 3. Else, now this is where instead of having elif, we're going to nest else and if mod x 3, 0, indent, right? Just to show where I am. Indent 1 to be here. Quite right here. Then, and it's free, it's fizz. Tab else, so it's not divided by 15. I mean, I could have done it one test with modulo 15, right? That would have been simpler, but at least I can show you the end and it looks exactly like the Python. Now, the last one, that's another if mod x 5 this time is null. Tab, then buzz. Else, now this is not going to work, I think, because it's not working. But it's not working for the. It's not working for the reason I was not thinking. Yes, okay. So I think that might be, sorry, it's not the very error expected, but that might be the same reason. The problem we have here is that function, like Haskell is strictly typed. So this function takes something that's a number, something on which you can do modular arithmetic, but this returns ostensibly strings, but then there's this x here. So by type inference, Haskell will assume that x needs to be a string because my other returns value is a string. And then it's finding out, oh, well, I can't do a modulo on a string. So 2 is number 2. The string 2 is the string 2. If I want to convert one to the other, I use show. Show and then a number that will give you the string of the number. That's casting to a string. That's the equivalent of, so in Python, really, to be consistent, this should be string I. And make sure you close the brackets. Otherwise, it's a draft. So else show x. This now. Yes, okay, so let's try and just my, so this works on individual numbers, divisible one. I didn't spell it correctly. I'll rename this to something shorter. That was one. It's one because that's the text one. Divise three. Fizz, etc. Right? So all I now I've got this logic, and there are ways of actually making it much smaller, right? Then my fizzbuzz becomes, if I wanted to do it to n, so fizzbuzz to n is equal to, now remember, ranges in Haskell, that's very convenient. You can do 1.10, all the number between 1 and 10. But with that notation, as the notation indicates here, that's much more mathsy, right? This will include the upper bound. The other thing you can do, and that was I think the last lesson, is map. Let's define a double function, double x equals 2 times x. That's my function. And I can map double onto a range from 1 to 10. And I will have a range from to 20 in pairs of 2. Now, of course, I could have simply done 2, 4.20, and that gives me the same thing because ranges, you can set start, end, and step. So fizzbuzz n is equal to, I'm going to map divisible to the range from 1 to n. Load it in. And if I do fizz, buzz 20, 1, 2, fizz 4, buzz, fizz 5, 7, buzz, and so on. And 15 is fizz buzz here. Now they're all strings and so on, but your interface could print that to the screen. So instead of doing things one after the other, we're just like checking them all notionally at the same time. Once you do map, you're saying, I want this function, divisible, apply to every element of this list, which itself is a Haskell generated range between 1 and 10. Now, it's not going to do first do it on the first one, then on the second one. It could, but it could potentially run them all in parallel because to do the previous one, to do this one, you don't need the previous one. In Python, that's the case true too, right? But because in here I could like set a local variable because in procedural you get state, if I and mutability, if I set like okay, so 15, because it was the variable 15 equals true, then at the next iteration of that, it's not used, etc. But I a subsequent later iteration in the thing, I could be that the state of that variable could affect the behavior of the code, which means that's why it's sequence, right? Things happen one after the other. That's why you get a state, things are mutable, and so on. Not so in functional programming, not so in Haskell, which requires like rejigging your head around it a little bit. Now, just one last thing. So, couple of key points here. Ifs are done like this, right? It's if test, then val A, else val B. Ifs need elses always. Another important thing, I'm going to put like some syntactically incorrect code. So that can I put chuck that in line? The modulo becomes mod. The end becomes, I don't want to kind of like refer to the Python, but if we speak Python, the end now needs to be ampersand ampersand. And here, strictly type, so need to return a string, return a string true, right? Because the other, if I feed a multiple of 3, 5, or 15 to this, it will return a string, so I need to be returning a string if it isn't. Those are the things we've learned. Another thing here, just so for mathematical operation that are not commutative, right, which is, that means they're not symmetrical. So A divided by B, that's not the same as B divided by A. It's neat, it helps. Like the infix notation is not super helpful. So you might want the prefix notation is not helpful. So you can put any function as infix by putting it in the middle, obviously, because that's infix, but wrapping it in backticks. Not to be confused with the apostrophe, right? Backticks, it will be on your keyboard in different places depending on your operating system. But now that reads a bit cleaner, that x modulo 5, x modulo 3, unless my comments have broken everything, and I can still do fizzbuzz to 30 this time. And the last one should be fizzbuzz because it's dividable by both, right? So we can do selection kinda, but we're selecting between expressions, rather return expressions that need to be of the same type rather than branches of the code. We can't do sequence, but we can emulate sequential behavior minus the state and mutability by operating on list with the map function. And what's the third one? And yeah, we can't do iteration because we can't do sequence. But we can emulate iterative operations and indeed sequential as a result by operating on lists, some of which might be automatically generated ranges, which is essentially your for. And that's BuzzFizz in Haskell in 14 minutes. Wow, just at the max capacity.